think, as a combined authority area. So there was total growth from LGF1 and LGF2, really big programme of work that started in that first year but didn't really get going in terms of spades in the ground in that first year. So obviously year one of the structure was very light in terms of cost. Moving on to the second year, which became, it was the CA really evolving into what you would recognise as the combined authority now, the LGF programme delivery picked up quite significantly. Holton Curve, Buglow Station, Liverpool North, as you mentioned, Ostrom, all of these were either developed or initiated in that year. We also attracted additional responsibilities for employment skills, economic development, highways and housing through the sort of next generation of the devolution deal. We had these immediate requirements for programme management, financial management related to growth, and also the single investment fund, which has just been referred to. The city region decided to pool that devolved funding and issue a call for projects that wanted support from this single investment fund. That started in June 2016, $185 million. It's really obvious at that point that the combined authority could no longer continue just with Merseyside providing the financial accountable body function, Knowsley providing the employment and skills function, and basically all the districts seconding or lending staff with relevant expertise. The combined authority was becoming a really big beast, needs to have its own structures. To that extent, you'll be aware there was a report on capacity back in June 2016, which gave some idea of what a structure might look like that would provide the capacity to deliver the devolution deal. That was built into the budget for last year. Many of the posts associated with that report were filled, but not the key strategic posts, the most visible posts. They were deliberately left pending the election of the Metro Mayor. Clearly, whoever became the Metro Mayor would have a really big say in what they wanted their strategic their structure to look like. But all the operational functions were filled and were maintained in that 2016-17. The cost of that as well. Even without a fully fulfilled structure in the 16-17 year, the running costs of the combined authority were about $3.5 million, you'll see after the published final accounts. That moves us into the current year. So Mayor Rotherham has had a look at what he launched in the senior structure and recommended to the combined authority, who accepted it in August, a much leaner management team than was originally anticipated. So there's significant savings in the management team. They're not savings that you can bank because none of those posts were filled anyway. It's just we had a report that suggested there would be a director, for example, for each of the disciplines of the combined authority. Mayor Rotherham thinks authority can continue with a more concentrated structure, which I'll come to. We also looked at the assumptions in the previous reports and budget, and I've worked just myself, but Frank Rogers, the interim head of paid service, sat with Steve long times and looked at how we could use economies of scale to minimise particular support costs but other costs as well. To come up with a structure that really only had the additional requirements, the additional posts that we needed for devolution and to fulfil the new responsibilities. So we lean in very heavily in the existing structure on resources at the left from economic regeneration, and particularly Merseyside Travel. So Merseyside Travel not just for transport, as you can imagine, but also for the support services, the financial services were appropriate. So as I'll come to, there's a current leadership team of four, and two of that leadership team have been in post since the election. Frank Rogers as interim head of paid service, and myself as So instead of, you know, having to have two directors or two heads of finance, you have the same one. You may need to build, we need to build capacity underneath, but it's obviously a lot more effective. There's a lot more economies of scale that can be delivered. Steve, I'm rather very keen on that. A couple of other posts at the senior level, which we'll come to in the report. One to be appointed to, and we'll start after his notice period, March, April time. And then there is another post where the final round of interviews is in, I believe, around February 14th. So that structure should be in place. What I hope to demonstrate, though, is that an awful lot of the structure underneath those senior posts is there, because we couldn't continue without it. There are a number of posts that still need to be developed, but a lot of the, what I call the engine room of the combined authority, is there. This is really a functional diagram. This is a functional diagram, really, which isn't quite a structured chart, but it's showing basically where the combined authority, the federal combined authority, how the structure's made up. So obviously, you've got at the top the elected city region mayor, who needs a chief executive. Okay, chief executive role's been fulfilled by Frank Rogers, who, his substantive post, as you know, is the MD of Merseytravel chief exec, who's fulfilling both roles at the moment. Just moving down, on that side, one of the areas where we've been able to take quite a bit of cost out of previous assumptions is on the economic development side, which is to work with the LEP and look at ways in which the combined authority and the LEP could work jointly within a more streamlined management structure. And that's really maximised the benefit of the LEP and minimise the additional resources that the combined authority need to deliver its economic regeneration side of the portfolio. Moving then next to that, you have transport. Other than you've got Frank covering both roles at the moment, that transport is fully populated. Merseytravel exists. Merseytravel leadership team is in place. Original assumptions for transport were that the combined authority would have quite a significant transport strategy, transport policy, capacity of its own. It was seen to be quite separate from Merseytravel. Again, sat with Steve, that's not the approach that we want, it doesn't make sense. We're going to lean on Merseytravel for that transport expertise and Merseytravel's equivalent in Colton, because Merseytravel doesn't deliver transport in Colton at the moment. The only additional post then that the combined authority need to deliver its transport aims at the moment are only related to the extra powers. So they relate to the key route network and highways and freight and logistics. So you're basically down to two additional posts for transport rather than previous assumptions, which was quite significantly more. The corporate services directorate is my own, where I'm the director of corporate services. I've got 151 responsibility or equivalent for both Merseytravel and the combined authority. Beneath that is going to be a finance function that can serve both. It needs more capacity, but it doesn't need more managers. It needs to have more qualified accountants, because clearly the numbers that we're looking after are significantly higher. It's a significantly different type of funding we need to manage. Managing capital programs is different than managing revenue program, which most of Chubb's finance team were based on. So we are bringing in skills, we're bringing in capacity, exactly the same with the legal side of it. And then there are economies of scale then between Merseytravel and the combined authority in areas such as committee services and executive PA support, and we'll have great benefit from those. In addition, you'll see in there that there's a dedicated role to support the alternative. Then you've got essentially the two new areas of policy and commissioning and commercial development and investment. These are where we, and the Rotherham is quite key, that the resources are put into place sufficient to deliver the devolution agenda. I mean, put simply, you have the Director of Policy and Commissioning, who would perform a role of being able to find out what sources of what the city region wants to do, what sources of funding are available, attract money into the combined authority for the Director of Commercial Development Investment, whose role is to make the best use of those investments from a really hard-edged commercial perspective. These are new functions to us, and they'll need to be appropriately resourced. At the moment, a lot of the policy development around devolution has been done with the assistance of the city region. The city region chief executive who leads on each of these areas. The employment and skills team, who's heading up the employment and skills team, they are in post, there's 11 of those. Those 11 posts, though, they are cost to the combined authority. As will each of the roles in that policy and commissioning will be an investment by the combined authority in that area. And the Director of Commercial Development, likewise, the significant staffing within that area. There already is quite a significant team of programme managers. We need that programme management office. It supports all your project managers and project sponsors for all your LGF schemes or your CIF schemes. But it's going to be a much bigger scale once the single investment fund starts making investments that aren't being led by local authorities, that have been led by private companies or third sector organisations. We still have to have the same discipline. So we have to make sure they're delivering. So the programme management office itself will probably be at least 15, but it's already a significant team of maybe 11. The Rotherham, again, is anxious that there is resources there that can dedicate to sustainable energy, tidal energy, but also pipeline development. Again, as Steve just stressed, we will lose out if we don't have schemes that are ready to just stop and go. If we can't put our hand up when government says it's ready, the money will just flow elsewhere. Again, at the other side of the structure, we have a mayoral advisor. The mayoral advisor's in post, and the mayor's office has been populated also. Head of communications and the comms office too. We've got people in there who are fulfilling those roles already. What that comes down to in terms of a full-time equivalence, it is at the moment, this is subject to the budget next year. It's also subject to the new policy and commissioning having a say on the whole structure. But you're looking at a net additional post of about 66 on top of the posts that are already in the combined authority. And again, from budget terms, there's already a significant cost in the combined authority. Combined authority will spend £6 million this year on its running costs. So the budget for next year is £6.2 million. It's not an extra £6 million next year that's been asked for. It's a recognition of how the £6 million that's been spent, a lot of it's been spent with third parties, it's been spent by districts recharging the combined authority for the work that districts have done, quite rightly. But there's other costs within the premises and transport, supplies and services, all the natural costs that get picked up at your own organisations. That's the compressed plan. Very briefly, this diagram is supposed to express what the combined authorities budget process looks like. It's trying to simplify it. Unfortunately, the colours haven't been produced very well. Well, basically, this is income. The CA, as you'll see when you see the budget paper, and again, we'll do some work with on additional training on the budget for yourselves. I think that's been, I was asked that, and that we can organise that, absolutely. that it's the revenue element of that gain share that we need for employment skills, business growth, work with apprentices, cultural programme. Those type of schemes that come forward from those areas don't tend to be capital. They're not about building infrastructure, they're about investing in people. So you need your revenue for that. Thus far, we've been able to balance it and spend some of that government grant on running costs, but government have been quite strong with us and said, whilst you can do that, you won't really significantly put at risk any future awards. And the 30 million isn't 30 million for 30 years. That's how the government presents it. It's 30 million for 5 years, and if you've complied with the conditions of that first 5 years, then you get it for another 5 years. So there's break clauses at every point that we need to be very aware of. And then clearly the CA takes account its income and then works out its expenditure from there. And again, in terms of size, the MERS running costs are a very small proportion of the overall budget. MERS travel funding is the greatest proportion of that by far. So that's funding that the CA gives MERS travel for its public transport remit, operating the Mersey tunnels, and also the Mersey rail network, which has been devolved to us. Together, those three are probably £220-230 million a year. So the budget process is a lot more than just the CA running cost. But clearly, the CA running cost is the new element of it this year, or the MERA running cost, which is attracted. Obviously, quite a lot, quite rightly, a lot of attention and a lot of scrutiny. The budget then for this year, as you see, will be based on that structure that just described, but also provide some capacity to develop tidal energy, digital connectivity, for the MERA to look at its powers in terms of bus network, which are new powers. Have been involved to us to see how the city region can make the best use of those powers. And also provide revenue funding for a number of task and finish pieces of work that still need to be done. Clearly we need to invest in future devolution, and again the region will lose out, and also fund these transport responsibilities that I just mentioned. So there is a significant revenue package in place that's been funded through government grants, the SIF, through the transport levy and through other income, but the mayor has been very anxious to minimise the burden on local taxpayers, so there's pressure not to put the transport levy up. Obviously the transport levy has gone down very significantly in the last 3 years, but also there's been the discussion around the precepts and how you fund the running costs in a way. The running costs themselves, adding up how much it's going to cost, is the easy bit. The difficult bit, obviously, is how you finance that. So the finance order is quite explicit. It says the cost of the mayor in a combined authority that are incurred in with the exercise of the new mayoral functions are to be met by a precept issued by the authority, etc. The second paragraph of that says, unless they can be met in other ways. So the precept is for those costs that you can't meet through other means. Now, we have been able to work out for next year a package with each of the districts that means that we don't need to switch the precept power on this year because we found other ways to fund it. That funding package has been teased out with each of the leaders of the districts. It's not